We've got a glove, we've got some knickers.
Richard North isn't used to picking up rubbish. The karate expert and father of four is the owner of a multi-million pound toy company.
Quite self-explanatory, really.
But he's leaving his life behind to live undercover in one of Cardiff's poorest areas.
A boyfriend had her by the throat with an axe.
A hell of a lot of crack and heroin.
And he'll become part of the community on one of the biggest estates in Wales. He'll look for and be introduced to people who might need his help.
Oh, he's got a strong handshake, look at that!
And come to terms with a secret that he's buried for over 20 years.
I feel like I've met up with him again.
At the end of his stay, he'll give away thousands of pounds of his own money when he reveals he's a secret millionaire.
Kids are better at it than I am.
For Richard North, life is all about having fun.
The kids do it all the time. If you're going to spend 50% of your life working, you've got to have fun.
The 43-year-old father of four is a multimillionaire who's made his fortune from being a big kid.
Best thing about being wealthy, freedom to be able to do what you want to do.
Actually, it goes quite well.
There's an element of still being a child in the nature of the work that we do, which is inventing toys and gifts. This is my office. As this plaque suggests, the buck stops here.
But it's not all child's play. Richard's toy company is now worth £35 million and sells to some of the biggest retailers in the world.
And you can do tricks. And I can turn it. This is the new flitter fairy. She's beautiful. You know, the term that we call magic nowadays really refers to illusions. And if those illusions really give wonderment to a child, then, yeah, I'm definitely a believer in that.
The toy tycoon has recently moved into his new family home, where he's planning some extensive renovations.
These are the plans for the work that we're going to do on the house. The cost is not far short of £1 million. This is where the kids go mad. I'm looking around, there's not a lot that we've actually got that we've designed here. This is one of ours. A buzzer. We've not put our own identity on the house yet, but my wife will. I'll find a way that we can afford it, and then she can spend it.
From an early age, Richard had a powerful incentive to earn money.
My brother, at the age of five, had a terrible stroke. My mum would often make the comment that we'd have to look after him as he got older. So I think a big drive for me was to earn enough money so I could pay for him to survive in life, really.
But at the age of 25, Richard's brother died in his sleep from a brain hemorrhage.
I got angry. Yeah, I remember being very, very frustrated and punching the wall no end of times and breaking my fingers and stuff, you know, because of the anger. You know, to just as I'm getting to know him, he's then taken.
For the next 8 days, Richard will be living undercover. He'll tell people he meets that he's a full-time karate instructor, a sport he's been involved with for the last 20 years.
There's a lot of analogies with business and karate. There's the discipline, the focus, the hard work. As an entrepreneur, you need that discipline to get to where you want to be.
Hi, Norman.
Hi.
Thank you.
I've worked hard in my business life, but I've also had quite a lot of luck. I've given before, but always in small ways and anonymously. So it's time now, very much, to give something back to other people.
He's travelling to Cardiff, where he'll look for people that might need his help.
It's going to be a tough week. It's going to be hard. Very apprehensive, very excited, but hoping and worrying that I do the right thing.
Cardiff has had billions of pounds spent on a massive regeneration programme, which has transformed the bay and the city centre. But on the outskirts, there are neighbourhoods that have been left behind.
Ah, these look local. Excuse me, you wouldn't know which bus I need to get to that address, would you?
Ely?
No.
Richard will be spending time on the Ely council estate, once the biggest in Europe.
That's the one. Thanks, mate. Cheers. Thank you.
Built after the First World War, the estate is one of the most deprived areas in Wales, with around 15,000 residents and a long-standing reputation for drugs and crime.
My goodness. Ah. No TV. Looks like someone's broken in at some point. You know, maybe is that a sign of the area that we're in?
He begins his search for people to help in his local neighbourhood.
I've seen some really tiny little kids wandering the streets. You hate the area. I'm hearing some pretty terrible stories at the moment. Will I find somebody between now and the next few days that I can really understand, that I can really feel for, that I can immerse myself really in the problems they've got? I don't know whether I'm going to be able to do that in such a short period of time.
This is going to be an interesting week.
There's a fire over here.
Toy millionaire Richard North is living undercover on the Ely council estate in Cardiff.
Looks like someone's had a bit of a party as well.
He's looking for people he might be able to help and will tell them he's being filmed for a documentary about community projects in capital cities.
She's only just had a job, so she's not allowed to work until Sunday.
Oh, hello.
We're just making a documentary about the community. Is there any one person or people that lead that or that to pull everybody together?
Pete and Linda, they like a residents association, and they actually go to the council and try and like fight on our behalf.
How would I get in contact with
Pete? I've got their number if you need it.
Be fantastic. Whoa. She mentioned Pete and Linda. She couldn't sing their praises high enough. Whoever Pete and Linda might be, and I'm hoping I can find out.
Hello.
Hi, is that Peter Sullivan?
Yep, speaking.
I've been given your name. I wonder whether it would be possible to kind of meet up with you and to ask you a bit about what you're doing.
Yeah, that'd be no problem at all. I've got a football training session later, so if you could pop round...
That'd be really great. What time is your football training?
5:30.
All right, I look forward to seeing you then.
OK, see you.
I'm absolutely rubbish at football. On a score of 1 to 10, I'm probably about a 0.5. How are you, mate? You all right?
Yeah.
How are you, Linda? You all right? Yeah. How you doing, mate?
Pete and Linda Sullivan help run a residents' association, which is trying to turn the community around. A year ago, they won a major battle to save their playing fields from development. Now they run free football training for the kids on the estate.
I'll take the little ones and then Rob will do the big ones, but
yeah.
We've got a good mix here today, so...
Do you want to stand? Just put the post up, really?
Yeah, of course, no problem.
Coach Rob Loader gives up his spare time to help out.
Who's the best football player then out of you lot?
Me!
Yeah?
Me!
You! And no fighting!
Me!
Come on then, Cam, keep it going!
Well done, Luke. Come on, that's it. Concentrate, that's it. Lovely. What are we doing then? Sorry, Rob. I'm doing well, aren't I, so far?
Right, come on in, guys. Let's have a drink.
What would you do if this place wasn't here?
Well, cry.
Yeah, I bet you'd cry.
What we want, really. We want more people involved, more community people, more local people. Get involved, coach the kids. You know what I mean? There's a lot of kids we'd love to drag off the streets and, you know, force to play football.
And so what would it mean if this wasn't here for you?
Boring, really.
Yeah. Wow, this is where the fun starts.
Yeah!
Pete and Linda invite Richard back to their home after the game.
Our first training session was a bit of a shock for us because we advertised it. There was only three of us and 150 kids showed up.
We had one football.
And we had one football. It gives them a name and it gives them a focus. Like you were saying with your karate, I think it's the discipline.
Police have turned around, haven't they, and said the crime rate have dropped dramatically nearly since the football teams have been going.
What do you guys do for a living?
I'm a train driver, a freight train driver, I am.
Freight train driver?
Yeah, so I do a lot of nights.
What's driving you?
Well, it's our grandchildren. This is their future generation. You know, I want them to grow up how I grew up, you know, happily playing in the fields. And we've lived it all our lives. These fields were us. My parents couldn't afford to take us on holiday. They were our holidays, you know. We spend all our summer holidays over there.
It's horrible, really, because it's Ely. We're like, you know, we got a stigma about us, and it's all. And I want to change that. I don't want Ely being shown in a negative way. I want it shown positive. There's so many good people up in this area.
See you. Bye bye. I've seen the sheer mountain that Peter and Linda are trying to climb. I've seen loads of kids on the street corners that are disillusioned, disaffected. It does make you rethink about what Pete and Linda are doing and whether they'll be able to achieve their goal.
Richard's looking for other people he might be able to help, but first he needs to do some research.
Oh, wow. This website that I've just hit on is talking about people with brain difficulties or head injuries, that kind of thing. I didn't know that. Approximately 50% of deaths in people under 40 are due to head injury. So I'd like to go and see this charity. Headway, it's called. And the age brackets that it talks about are the same as my brother when he died. I remember him sitting on the bathroom seat having one of his attacks. I remember actually saying to him, sit down, relax. And he kept saying, don't tell mum, don't tell dad. If I'd have had the sense about me at the time to have realised something was really, really wrong with him, and I could have then just pushed or told my mum, despite what he said, just told her that something's wrong here. I think there's definitely something could have been done and wasn't done. And could I have pushed it? I've thought about that before and thought, I think I could have done. I'm going to be scared of what I might be reminded of, the people that I might see there that have recovered or nearly recovered from what he had. And he never got that chance.
Determined to find out more, Richard signed up to volunteer at Headway's Day Centre.
Hi there.
Can I just grab your attention a sec? This gentleman's name's Richard. He's come round today to see what...
Hi!
He's come to see what Headway's all about.
The Cardiff branch of Headway has around 300 members from across South Wales who are learning to live with the effects of brain injury. Staff members and volunteers help clients to relearn basic skills and increase their confidence.
Just introduced to Peter. He's one of our longest-serving volunteers.
How you doing?
Hi, Richard.
How are you?
Hello,
nice. You're right. Yeah, call me Rich.
Peter is also Headway's treasurer and has his own personal reasons for wanting to help this organisation.
Yeah, my son is head injured. He had his accident about 18 years ago, so...
18 years he had? What happened?
Would you believe? Fell off his skateboard. Hit his head on the ground and the rest is history, you know. Richard, Jeff.
How are you, Jeff? You all right? Nice to meet you. I'm Richard. Rich.
Me.
How are you? You all right?
Well, yeah.
Your dad's told me about you. Yeah. Yeah. You're good at pool. That was that close.
I used to be good at pool when I had tennis on my right arm, but now it hampers me, hampers my game.
14, scorer.
14. Okay.
This is Matt.
Hi, Matt.
Matt.
How are you, mate?
Richard.
I'm Richard. How are you, mate?
Hello,
you all right?
Yeah.
How you doing, Rich?
How are you, mate?
Oh, you all right? Lovely, but thanks.
Good. James, oh, he's got a strong handshake. Look at that.
Three.
How old are you, Matt?
40 now.
40? Yeah. Yeah, I'm 43. What happened in your accident then?
When I was born, my arteries and veins weren't joined together properly. And basically, it was like a ticking bomb. It was going to blow up at some point, you know.
My brother had the same thing.
You joker, I've never found anyone else. Oh, amazing. I found someone at long last.
Yeah, AVM. Yeah, oh, with all good. The blood clots from birth. And we never knew, never knew.
What's his name?
Jonathan.
Oh, well, say hello, Jonathan.
Oh, say hello. You just said hello to him.
I tell you, I've always tried to find someone. Could I have your address on you?
Yeah, of course.
Really? I'd like to write to him.
And he had a stroke when he was 5, and he was carrying this throughout his life, but we didn't understand it at the time, and so he had more complications, and then he died. But that was a long time ago. But what you described was exactly what my brother had. See you, Matt. See you, Matt. It hasn't sunk in at the moment. When it hit me, it was a shock what he said. I didn't expect to find somebody that's got something so close to Jonathan. And I want to find out a bit more and find out whether that... I'm going to ask Matt some more questions. I kind of put a name to the condition that my brother had. And put a face to how he would be today.
Hey! Hey, Lynn!
You can hear the sound of kids. Hi, Pete.
In an effort to clean up their estate, the Ely Garden villagers have organised a litter pick, and they've invited Richard to come along.
I've got a bin as well, and I'll take a bin round with me.
And what are we watching out for, Pete?
If we do happen to come across any strangers, if you could call me, I've got a proper sharps box in the van for the sharps.
Okay. Hey, well done, well done. Look at that, I mean, it fills up quick. It's a lot of stuff.
You found a pair of knickers?
No.
What a difference. Within a couple of minutes.
Yeah.
Team effort.
Everybody grab it.
Yay!
We've got some trousers, we've got a glove, we've got some knickers. If you can just get me a top, then it's a done deal. Where'd you get... just found that?
Yeah.
I found five socks.
You found five socks?
That's it, kids, we got the full set. Big kick!
It's crazy that kids in the community want to pick up litter and get such great fun out of it. You know, and they're all running around, I've got this, I found this.
Big one! Oh!
Got to stand by here, kids.
Have we got everyone in? Yeah? Got everyone?
Where's your
little picker, Pete?
Excellent.
The children are helping out more because they came to the group and said they wanted to take part. They felt grown up. They just really needed to be included. I think that's why they carry on, because they're grateful they weren't left out. I think the Ely Garden villagers have made a big change, to be honest with you, two people in Ely, you know. Like it says, give them a power of, well, somebody does really care. Hatfields make happy kids.
Yeah, happy kids.
Yeah.
Probably make happy parents.
Yeah, that's it.
You've got a full-time job and you're doing all this stuff for the community. So when do you have some free time?
We don't really. The only day we turn around and we say, right, that's it, is a Sunday when we have all our grandchildren here. So we try and make that a special day for those, because we've been accused even by our children of neglecting them because we're so occupied with everything we're doing. It's the same as like holiday. Really, we haven't we haven't had a break for over 3 years. It's been a case of the money's been tight as well. It is a lot of commitment, but if people are out there and not happy with their community and the way things are, do something about it. Don't just sit there and moan about them kicking a football out the front. You know, if they're kicking a football out the front
because they want to do something.
Yeah.
You know, so help them.
Hearing them talk about all the things they do and they're not paid to do any of it, every step of the way, they're fighting battles. I think it is a big undertaking for them to take all this on themselves. That's total dedication for you, absolute dedication, and then some. It's a police helicopter. I think so.
Guns.
Oh, really? Guns?
Apparently, a boyfriend had it by the throat with an axe.
He had a boyfriend had it by the throat with an axe. Jeez. Is there? A lot of drugs. The guy lives next door to him is some kind of mad axeman, and they had 25 armed police with machine guns around the house to arrest him. And here comes the police helicopter again. I kind of thought I'd talk to the people, hear their stories, find out the problem, bang, there's some money. And then the more you talk to them, you start to know them. And the more that you know them, the more you want to know them and know more about them. It hasn't been what I was expecting. It's nothing like I was expecting.
Multi-millionaire Richard North is on a secret mission on the Ely Council estate in Cardiff.
Nothing in my life puts me in contact with people like I've met here. So it's been thrilling, exciting, occasionally scary, because this isn't something I'm used to.
These girls were having a lot of trouble with them. What they're doing, they're literally pulling them off and climbing in through the windows.
Today, the Ely under-11s football team are playing an away match. Richard's meeting Pete Sullivan to pick up some equipment for the game.
What we do is we go round the charity shops all over Cardiff and we get the boots, you know, and hand them out to the kids.
What's that?
Oh, that's the empty space where our boiler once belonged.
And what happened to it?
They broke in, kicked the door down and pinched it.
Oh.
Yeah, all these holes, they got in here and they just smashed the place up with bricks. The big boiler we did have literally ran all these shower heads all around. But to replace the boiler, it's £8,000. The avenues I've gone down for funding, but nobody's really interested because Ely being Ely would always last to have what's left in the pot anyway.
Fort Knox. It's not just money that these people need. It's people like Pete. It's inspirational leaders. I'm thinking how I can make a difference. I can certainly see some easy wins, but I want to look at it in a bit more detail.
11-year-old Lynn Escott lives on the estate and is one of the team's best players.
Do you ever see any problems around where you live?
Yeah. I see like arguments and everything. It was like last year. There was like about 8 police vans down into a circle because everybody was arguing down there.
And you watched it?
Yeah.
Doesn't it scare you?
The Ely under-11s are playing against local rivals, the Grangetown Boys Club, and competition is fierce.
Lovely. Good ball. Oh! This really gets you going, doesn't it, this?
I think on a Saturday morning, this is what we live for. Yeah. For the boys and...
You live for it.
Honestly, we do.
And Pete and Linda seem to be charging ahead and trying to do a lot of things.
It seems I speak to them on a weekly basis, Peter. To be honest, they phone us and let us know about training and... I think you have to be 100% in it for the kids or not at all sort of thing, and there's nowhere else for us to play sort of thing, so that's where we go. And well, I wouldn't like to think what would happen if there was none of that up there sort of thing.
All the way, son, all the way.
Take yourself, Lewis.
Yes, Lewis! Let's just get one more.
Linda!
Lynn today, she took one heck of a knock on the twist of her ankle. She had a few tears in her eyes through the pain, and she was straight back out there.
Ely.
Come on, Ailey!
That kind of represents the Ely community. They get a knock and they get straight back up. And they're constantly getting knocks. They still fight back.
Lynn's whole family has come along to watch her play.
So what does the football mean to her?
It's brought her out of her shell, to be honest. She was a bit sort of like, you know, inside herself, probably because of her mother's condition.
That's your wife, she's not well?
No, she got a heart condition. It's what killed her mother. She lost her mother when she was 8. You know, and she's like 34 now, so there's... her uncle's got it, one of her uncles have got it, and they've only given him like 5 years left at work. Obviously, Marie's at home when she finishes school, being the oldest child. You know, I think there's a bit of pressure on her.
Well done, Green Soul.
They know they've got it all to do. What was the walk like to get onto the pitch? Was it? Is this a big effort for you to have walked over here?
Oh, it is.
Who carried your oxygen tank?
He was on the back of the pram.
Back of the pram.
I'm too tired then. I've got to start there and start again.
It'll take a long time to get to the shops then. I could picture my daughter just as the same smiley face. My kids don't have the pressures and the worries that Lynn has.
You're right, Lynn. Well done. Well done.
You know, my daughter's almost the same age and, thank goodness, doesn't have to look after an adult that would take her away from a childhood. But that's really clear that Lynn has got that issue and that this football completely takes her away.
We didn't stop fighting, ever.
I feel like one of the community, because I've got involved and they've let me become involved. So I'm doing the things that they do. I'm talking to who they talk to. So I do feel one of them.
Richard wants to learn more about Headway. The charity promotes independence and self-confidence for people living with brain injuries. And today, they've taken the group to a climbing centre.
Adrian, if I fall, you're supposed to catch me.
Yeah. Okay, so Adrian is going to pull down on that rope like he's ringing a bell. Can you manage that, Adrian?
No.
Yeah, you can.
Richard's keen to find out from Peter Mayle and his son Jeff how Headway has helped them to move forward after Jeff's skateboarding accident.
I've seen people come to Headway initially, reserved, quiet, afraid, but yeah, they come along, meet others and talk about their problems, you know, and that helps, I think.
If it happened to someone, I'm glad in the way it was me, because I done with it.
That's a very honourable thing to say, isn't it? That glad it happened to him and not somebody else.
I've heard people being very positive about their life, their new situation, you know?
Yeah.
And they're enjoying it.
Yeah.
And have that positive attitude.
Positive attitude is absolutely fantastic, Jeff.
Having discovered that Matthew Cook survived a brain hemorrhage identical to the one that killed his brother, Richard's eager to spend some quality time with him.
You nervous, Matt?
Not at all.
He's such a strong, powerful, positive individual, so bright. I've never come into contact with anybody that's had something that appears to be the same as what my brother had.
We're getting there.
I think if Jonathan had still been here, he'd have been really, really positive. And he would have gone along to Headway and he would have got involved.
And then we're going to push from there to that orange one across. That's it, use that purple one to pull yourself up. Yeah? That's it, go on. That's it, and then big pull. One last pull, and that's the highest you've been. Well done, well done.
Headway's been fantastic, hasn't it? Headway's been a rock for them, a real rock.
I bet your muscles are aching on your arm. Yeah? Does it feel?
No pain, no gain.
I feel like I've met up with him again. And he's talking through them. And everything he's saying is positive. Everything he's saying is good. And I felt I've been brought to him today. I'd like to find out how Matthew's injury happened. I've heard it from Matthew, but I'd like to see the effect it's had on the family.
Hello, hello there. Hi, Matt's dad.
That is.
Oh,
Gary.
Richard, how are you?
Hi, Gary. Richard. You're all right.
Come on in.
Thank you. How important was your mum and dad for you to get through this?
I wouldn't have been able to cope if they weren't there, put it that way. I know of one or two my friends in Headway, when they had their injury, their parents have split up or whatever, for whatever reasons. So they don't have the, they haven't had the benefits that I've had of knowing that. When I eventually did come through, Mum and Dad were still going to be there for me, you know. Family and friends, if you don't have that, then...
Where do you see things going from here?
Well, Matthew, after all this time, has been offered a place in a purpose-built block of flats. But it is a complete change for Matthew, because he's never in 17 years, since his brain hemorrhage, been on his own. I won't run down the shop and leave him, you know, in case of things. So it is something, again, like from when he had the hemorrhage, it's something almost as traumatic as that in that respect, that it's going to be that much of a change.
Like Richard's brother, Matthew suffered from seizures before his brain hemorrhage.
My brother had a room, also downstairs. I've mentioned this before, but my issue was just that I thought there was something wrong.
Yeah, yeah.
I did. I really thought and believed there was something seriously wrong.
Why did you think there was something wrong then?
Because I saw his fits close up, and I just had this feeling that it should be looked at, that something, you know, that should just... you know, say to Mum and Dad, take a look, or get him to hospital because something's not right.
Yeah.
And then, because he kept saying, don't, whatever you do, don't. I just never did.
When he had the fit back home, it was out of the blue. It wasn't until his college mates came down when he was in intensive care, and his brother said he's had other ones, quite a few, from the time of his original one, when I went up 2 or 3 years previous, that he had four or five. In hindsight, it's always, you know, you just got to get on with it. As you say, at the end of the day, it would drive you potty.
Well, you're not just still here, Matt, you know. You're here, and you're spectacularly here. It's just really inspirational. Thanks very much. Thank you. See you soon.
See you soon. Bye-bye.
Gary was very reassuring and said, look, we all could have done some things in hindsight, but that's life. But in my brother's case, it wasn't life, so it was death. And, but would things have been different? Would we have done, could we have even saved him? Could anything have been done? I don't know, we'll never know. Because I've learned that you could live after a brain hemorrhage and live a good life. So I'm really thinking, I can do something for Matt, and I'm just thinking, what? I've got some ideas.
As part of his cover story, Richard's told everyone he's met that he's a full-time karate instructor. He's offered to run a free class in Ely for Pete Sullivan's under-11s football team.
Hi, everyone.
Hi,
Pete. Hi, Linda.
For me, this is not just a normal room. It's not a gymnasium. It's not a part of the school. Right now, this room is my dojo. Good punch. Ooh, like it. Don't look at where you're about to kick. Look at me in the eyes. See? Absolutely, Lin Shon.
every time I looked around the class, her eyes were fixed. She was wanting to learn more. She was wanting to do it. It's the same with the football. That was noticeable.
And line up, feet together. There. This.
Well done.
I can see what you have to go through with the kids. They're a boisterous lot, aren't they?
They are. They're extremely boisterous. It's hard. You just got to keep them there, haven't you? Well, you've done well. You've kept them... very impressed by you.
Richard's facing some big decisions about who he's going to help. But there's one more visit he'd like to make before he leaves.
I would like to find out more about Lynn's family. I kind of immediately felt a connection there.
Hi, Lynn.
Hello.
Are you all right? Can I come in?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Marie Escott has an incurable heart problem that prevents her from doing simple tasks.
I'm just looking at this here, and that's your machine, is it?
That's my oxygen machine.
Your oxygen machine?
It's a bad gene, but they don't know if I got a gene or it's hereditary, because my mum died of it. The children got to be tested as well, so so they've got it.
Yeah. Is it exhausting sometimes?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. The day she came home from school, I said, I'm tired, so let me go sleep for an hour. So she did.
Yeah. Does Lynn have anything to do in the house? Does she give her
she
chores?
She does. We've she both told her not. If I'm putting on too much pressure on her, please let me know.
When we found out about the condition, I did say to Lynn, being the oldest, I said, look, if you think Mum is taking the mick, then turn round and tell her. So, but she's good as gold when she wants to be.
Yeah? What do you do to help Mum? Do you make a cup of tea?
Yeah.
Are you a good tea maker?
Yeah.
Yeah? He talked to Rob. He suddenly realised that, you know, she's in a bad state. I've got a financial safety net that even if I couldn't pay to cure somebody in our family, that we can at least make their life a little bit better and have luxuries that would perhaps brighten up the day. They haven't got any of that. And there's Lynn, just smiling still and getting the cups of tea. Helping her mum. Brave girl.
Richard's time in Cardiff as a secret millionaire is coming to an end. Tomorrow, he'll reveal his true identity and give away thousands of pounds of his own money. It's the final day in Cardiff for toy tycoon Richard North. Today, he'll give away thousands of pounds of his own money and confess to being a secret millionaire.
That feels fantastic. The best ever feeling I've had when spending money. They'll be certainly very happy, elated, over the moon, but they won't know how much it means to me.
Hey.
Hi, Lynn. Hello.
I wanted to say, Lynn is a credit to you guys as parents, the way you've brought your kids up. And she's always smiling. She's always laughing. And you know, Lynn, how I told you I'm a full-time karate instructor? Yeah? Well, you know what? That's not what I am. Do you know what I do? I'm actually a very successful businessman. And I'm lucky enough to be a millionaire. And I know you have a lot of difficulties. And I know how Lynn loves Liverpool.
Yes.
Yeah? Well, now you're going to go to the football club and you're going to go on a soccer school there. And I'm also going to help you out with just a few bits and pieces. So I've just got a small check for you. What does it say?
10,000. Oh my God.
That is for you guys.
Thank you.
Because
very much.
I think you're absolutely wonderful. You. And a fantastic job.
Thank you.
Well done, mate. Well done. You know, I hope that some of that money can help give you some respite as well, so that you can really kind of move on and feel positive again about life.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
They're absolutely amazing what you've done to me. Just can't believe I got that much money.
10,000. I'm gonna cry.
It feels like a privilege to be able to do something in a way that I know will change their lives. Hi, Pete.
How's it going?
Oh, yeah. Good, thanks, mate. How are you doing?
You guys deserve the biggest pat on your backs. You really done recognition.
We know Ely is a really nice community, and it, you know, we knew it, you know, it doesn't deserve the slander that it's been given.
Well, you know, you're like, I'm a full-time karate instructor. Actually, I'm not. I'm actually a very successful businessman, and I'm a millionaire.
Bloody hell. It's
really an Ely.
And I want to do something for you now because of what you've done selflessly, tirelessly for everybody else here. It's a cheque for £15,000.
Bloody hell, Rich.
That I want to give to you.
Oh, thanks. Do you know what it just means to us?
Thanks so much, Chris.
Thank you.
Oh. You can do your boiler.
Yeah.
Or you can do your boiler, you can do your showers.
I got loads of shaking to work.
And I found out that you got a little bit of debt, haven't you? You got about £3,000. And you've also not been on a holiday. You don't have any debt anymore. Oh. And you're definitely going to go on a holiday. And I got another cheque for you. This is for you too.
Rich.
This is for you too. This is for £5,000.
This is like winning the lottery. Thanks.
They take things off us, not give anything.
You know, due to injuries and everything and work, I haven't been able to do any overtime. And it'd be just nice to be out of debt, to be honest with you. Very nice, indeed, you know. We do tend to have little fallouts, me and Linda, with, I think it's just down to all the pressure we're under. So, yeah, a holiday would be nice. Fantastic. Good, very good, freely, yeah. We don't get a lot up here, so any, you know, little or big in this way is fantastic.
This is a personal one on several levels for me now. Really excited, nervous, but I'm looking forward to this.
Hello, Pete.
Hello, Rich.
Yeah, how are you, mate?
Nice to see
you're
you
right.
Again. Yeah.
Thanks for seeing me. Fantastic experience for me to see all those people. And how well Headway copes with everybody and what it does. You remind me, with Jeff, of my dad with my brother. Yeah. And I could see the same bond that you've got. You know, I've not been totally straight with you, Pete. I'm not exactly who you think I am.
You're not Richard?
I am Richard.
Right.
But I'm a full-time businessman and I'm very, very lucky enough to be a millionaire. And I want to help Headway. So yeah. I've got a small cheque for you here. It's for £20,000.
Oh, grand. Oh, that's absolutely brilliant.
Okay.
Thank you very much indeed.
You're so very welcome, Pete.
That is
so very
brilliant.
Welcome.
Now, this is absolutely fantastic, so.
Yeah.
God bless you.
To say I'm surprised is an understatement. No, this will go a long way to helping the charity.
This is the one I'm most scared of. It just brings back too many thoughts that are a bit painful for me at the moment. Yeah, in many ways, I'd rather just push it through the letterbox and go home.
Hey.
Hi.
How are you doing?
Gary? You're right.
Yeah, not too
yeah.
bad.
Hello, Matt.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm great.
Though. You're right, yeah. I've come to the end of my adventure down here and I got something to tell you. I'm not exactly who you think I am. I'm a full-time businessman and I'm very lucky enough to be a millionaire. I want to do something that will ease you moving into your new house.
This is a wind-up, isn't
it? It's not. This is no wind-up, mate. This is for you. And I've got a small gift for you. This is for you, Matt. It's a cheque for £10,000.
Oh, my gosh.
To help you with your new place. Oh, because you know what, you've helped me find a lot of answers to my concerns with my brother. And now if he was here, he'd be like you.
I feel like I am his friend, even though I never knew him, you know, from what you told me about.
To be honest, Richard, I never for a minute, but thank you so much. That is fantastic.
Hopefully now, through doing this, your guilt will be taken away, hopefully, because you shouldn't have any. Don't worry, mate.
No, I just say it.
He's up there looking at us. Don't worry, after you.
Yeah. I think it's a very brave thing you've actually done, Richard, you know.
Thank you, mate.
Thanks for what you've done for
Matthew. Felt like my shoulders have been heavy for quite a long time and I've never known why. Now it does feel like the burden's gone. It's felt a bit like there's a guarded secret inside of me that I won't show anybody. And then suddenly, coming out of Matt and Gary's house, I feel like I've gone like that and said, look, it doesn't matter. I feel free. It's more than a privilege to have been where I've been and to have spoken to people I've spoken to. It's an absolute honour. A real, real honour. I hope they know that.
Hi there, mate.
Hello.
Hello.
Lifting the lid on one of the most sensational stories of the year, charting the rescue of the 33 miners buried alive, the Chilean mine rescue, Wednesday at 8. Next, Paul's introducing the new wife to the other desperate housewives.